In the summer of 1950, Harry Truman sat in the White House while I sat with my friends, Tommy and Johnny, on the curb of West 10th Street in Marion, Indiana, spotting cars. Fords, Buicks, Hudsons, even Kaisers, Henry J's, and Crosleys, we knew them all. Our heroes were Roy Rogers and Gene Autry and, to a lesser degree, Hopalong Cassidy, who was a bit too stern, lacked a cute sidekick like Dale, and couldn't sing a note. In post-World War Indiana, young boys played with pistols and shooting pretend Indians was not politically incorrect. I spent most of my allowance towards buying caps for my two six-shooters. I walked to Marion Elementary School, went to Cub Scout meetings, and read my little golden books. I also read my Grimm's Fairy Tale book from cover to cover, completely ignorant of the association with our recent enemies, the Germans. I had a small record player, a few 78 RPM story records. My favorite was Little Toot, the brave little harbor tugboat. I loved comic books, especially Superman. On special occasions, I would receive a dollar from my Aunt Dorothy's husband, Bob, and I would run to the drugstore and stock up. I overheard that Bob had many faults. He drank, he smoked, he gambled, and apparently couldn't hold a job. But as far as I was concerned, he was a great guy. We rented a simple white house on South Gallatin Street. I had my own room. I had a dog named Skippy. I was feeling pretty good about life in Indiana. My father, Wendell, was the naval recruiting officer in Marion, Indiana. I remember his office in the courthouse basement. It smelled like old newspapers. He visited high schools, showed recruitment films, and enlisted young men for the Navy. There was a war going on in Korea, but I don't recall that it was a topic of conversation. The adults talked about their jobs. Grandpa West still worked at the Anaconda wire factory. Mom worked for a few months at the RCA television tube plant. In the winter, I made snowmen and hung out at Dad's office. I was hungry for reading material and read the Enlisted Man's History of the U.S. Navy twice. I liked the heroism of John Paul Jones, the toughness of the New England sailors, and the drama of the battle between the Monitor and the Merrimack. In the spring, I was in the scout parade downtown and anxious for our big summer trip to Florida. Aunt Carmen joined us on vacation in Florida. Her husband, Tony, owned a machine shop in Chicago. They had a fine brick home with a bar, a den, a large barbecue. Each year, Tony would buy a new Oldsmobile 98 for himself and a Model 88 for Aunt Carmen. She dressed in fine clothes and furs, even exotic animal furs. They seemed rich to us, and I always looked forward to her gifts. They would arrive in boxes from the finest department stores in Chicago. In Florida, I collected hundreds of shells, which I took back to Indiana with no purpose in mind. Mom thought I should take them to school for show and tell. When the teacher asked me to tell the class about them, all I could offer was, "They're seashells." An embarrassing lesson for the future. Don't go to a presentation unprepared. Dad bought a new car that year, a 1951 Pontiac, two-tone, green, with a straight-eight engine and a hydromatic transmission. That summer of 1951, we crossed town to visit Grandpa Wes and Grandma Hallie Pence at their house on West 2nd Street. On Sundays, we picnic in the park. I remember the tall swings, the humidity, and the sudden Midwest rainstorms. In the evenings, we sat on the front porch of Grandpa's house, drank sweet iced tea, and watched fireflies. For a dime, I could buy a cold Coca-Cola from the machine at the Shell station two blocks away. Grandma's specialties were chicken stew and homemade noodles, which she concocted in a tiny kitchen in their two-story brick house. Grandpa Wes's specialties were chewing Red Man tobacco, drinking beer, cussing, and trying to win a few bucks from Wendell or Uncle Max, Uncle Daryl, or Uncle Hilton. In the fall, we spent a few days on Lake Durrett, fishing and staying in a primitive lakefront cabin with an outhouse. We caught perch and bluegill using worms for bait. I cleaned my share and Mom fried them for dinner. We ate fried fish, corn on the cob, drank more iced tea. I learned to row a boat, start an outboard motor. It was the happiest time in my young life. Mom threw me a birthday party for my growing group of friends, in particular, Johnny Moore, my best friend, and Tommy from across the street. One month later, Christmas of 1951, I got my first new bicycle, a 21-inch red Sears bicycle with training wheels, and my first chalkboard to get ready for the next show and tell. This was our last Christmas in Indiana. In the spring, Dad got his orders to go to the Kodiak Island in the territory of Alaska. It was not a state yet. We would leave Indiana in the spring of 1952. On our way to Alaska, we visited Mom's mother, Grandmother Margaret, and her second husband, Fred Taylor. Their child, my Uncle Dick, was only 2 years older than me. We visited Mom's sister, Dorothy, my cousin, Joanne. Cousin Joanne was 2 years younger. They all lived in the San Diego area and were my closest family friends. Grandpa Ham lived in La Mesa with his second wife. He had divorced my grandmother, Margaret, and married a younger woman. Her name was Mabel. Mom and her sisters were convinced that Mabel was after Fred's money and would get all of it when he died. They were right. Grandpa Fred had a nice house in La Mesa, a violin, an accordion, and a color television set. He raised fruit, cast concrete pots, and made birdhouses with his jigsaw. I could have spent more time with him. And I wish he had given me the violin in his will. It was a Stradivarius, which in 1952 was worth perhaps $1,000. Today, it's probably worth several hundred thousand. We left for Kodiak Island, Alaska, at the height of the Cold War. We were a few hundred miles from Russia, and in the event of war, we figured to be the front line. From time to time, there were alerts and rumors of Russian action. We didn't realize exactly what an H-bomb could do, but we were told to hide under a desk.
He did what we all must learn to do.
You
and you
and you
and you.
Duck and cover.
President Eisenhower and Vice President Dick Nixon were in office, but I don't remember seeing any news in Alaska. Even a newspaper. Dad worked at the machine shop at the naval base on Kodiak Island. We lived in a rented house in town with two bedrooms, one bath, an oil heater, a radio that received one station, and no books. I was bored most of the time. There was one movie theater in town, and for a quarter you could see a double feature, which they changed every week. On Friday nights, Mom and Dad would take me to the Officers Club, where we sat on a vinyl couch with chrome arms in front of a pull-down screen and watched black and white movies. After the movies, Mom and Dad drank highballs while the jukebox played songs by Hank Williams and Perry Como. I walked to school in the dark that fall and walked home in the dark as well. Sunrise was after 9 a.m. and sunset was about 2 p.m. The school was so small that my fourth grade class of 10 students shared a room with the fifth grade class. By the time we left Alaska, I had read every book in the library. It was a small library. Kodiak Island is home to the largest bears in the world, the Kodiak brown bear. I didn't get a chance to see a real one, but there were several stuffed specimens in the town. Kodiak is in southern Alaska and warmer than Juneau or Fairbanks. Still, we got a fair amount of snow, and it was a struggle to keep the Pontiac on the roads, especially after a night at the club. Late that winter, in early 1953, Dad went into that same downtown movie theater, took a seat, and slit his wrists. At the time, they called it a nervous breakdown, and I have never completely understood what happened in Alaska to cause it. Within a few days, he was transferred to the Naval Hospital in Oakland, California, and Mom and I were on a plane back to the States. We flew on a 4-engine military transport plane with bucket seats along the sides. As we neared California, one of the engines failed. The pilot assured us that we could land safely on 3 engines, which sounded fine to me, but Mom was anxious and probably scared. We landed just fine, and the flight provided good conversational material for years. In Oakland, California, in 1953, my religious education consisted of seeing the robe at the VA hospital where my father was recovering.
Did you see him?
Who?
Mom and Dad left me in the theater while they had an adult conversation.
He stopped here and looked at
what they discussed, I never knew. My parents were bigots and had no tolerance for blacks, Japanese, Jews, Chinese, Italians, or Mexicans. Ironically, I finished 4th grade in Oakland at an all-black elementary school, living in the black project housing. Our neighbor had a Cadillac, but no money for gas, except on Sundays. I felt a little richer because even though we only had a green Pontiac, it had gas. I felt sad because that neighborhood, in spite of the occasional gasless Cadillac, was dirt poor. The lack of hope was palpable, school was overcrowded, and I felt trapped. The highlight of the year was the arrival of our first television set. I watched Sid Caesar and Jackie Gleason, and for lack of proper materials, built a model airplane out of toothpicks. Dad had to stay at the VA hospital for several months, but Mom managed to get us out of the Oakland projects. She rented a small house in Berkeley, took a job, and enrolled me in 5th grade in a very good elementary school. By the spring of 1954, I had become a junior police officer in the traffic patrol. Traffic patrol was a very big deal at that school. We had snappy red sweaters, yellow caps, and marched like Marines to our posts at the intersections around town. The defeat of the French in Indochina that year would eventually involve us in Vietnam and consume some of my fellow traffic patrol officers.
Please don't pass me by.
Grandpa Ham visited us in San Francisco that year, and I got my polio vaccine. A very big deal in the 50s. Up to then, we all lived with the real prospect of winding up in an iron lung.
While the wheel is spinning, 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 I'm not...
We moved to La Mesa, where I finished 5th grade, got a 3-speed, 26-inch bicycle, and watched Martin and Olsa Johnson explore Africa on the television. Movies were better than ever and more often in color. Mom loved musical movies, a romantic at heart. Tony and Carmen wrote to us from Egypt on their way to Kenya. Aunt Carmen shot an elephant and my Uncle Tony shot a lion on that trip, and I was very envious. They had an enviable life, but that illusion was shattered a year later when Carmen committed suicide. We visited my Uncle Max and my 2 cousins, Susie and Sarah, and enjoyed a visit from Grandpa Wes and Grandma Hallie. Dad received a medical discharge from the Navy, got a job at Convair in San Diego, and bought a house in El Cajon with wall-to-wall carpeting, 2 bathrooms, and a fireplace. On our first Christmas in El Cajon, I finally got a model airplane with a gas engine. Life was getting more interesting. I was in 6th grade at Cuyamaca Elementary, my 6th elementary school. We visited Aunt Dorothy or Grandpa Ham every weekend, and Mom, inspired by the Lawrence Welk show, enrolled me in accordion class. I watched Davy Crockett and the Mouseketeers on television and looked forward to visiting Disneyland. One day in the spring of 1955, Grandpa Ham fell asleep in his chair watching his color television and died. He was 74. We never saw Mabel or the Stradivarius again. There was talk about a new singer named Elvis Presley. The phrase, rock and roll, had not yet been created. At the end of the 6th grade, I received the school citizenship award, along with a gift certificate from McMahon's Furniture Store for $25. I would have preferred a gift certificate from the hobby shop. In the fall of 1955, I entered 7th grade at the age of 11. Each day I rode the bus to El Cajon Junior High, carrying my lunch and my books. I avoided the most dangerous of the bullies who smoked cigarettes and wore low-slung Levi's, penny loafers, and sported ducktail haircuts with sideburns. I made a few new friends and excelled in all my classes, except gym. That Christmas, we had the usual get-together with Mom's sister, her husband, and my cousin Joanne. In 1955, swirled carpet was apparently popular. In 1956, my parents are in their first home at 702 Laguna Avenue, El Cajon, California. They have two cars and one child, me. They are looking like a normal family. In the summer of 1956, we went to Disneyland with Uncle Max, Aunt Glennis, and my cousin Susie. I used my E tickets to ride the submarines and the Jungle Cruise, my C tickets to ride Peter Pan, and my A tickets to ride the carousel. I wish they still used the ticket books instead of the passes. Dad was 38 years old. Early each morning, he drove 30 miles to Convair and spent all day on his feet machining metal parts. On weekends, he worked on the house, the yard, or the cars. He liked to work up a sweat all morning, then relax in the shade with a beer and his barbecue. He finally had enough money for a second car, a lime green 1955 Ford wagon. By the time I entered 8th grade at El Cajon, I built model airplanes with Kenny, played ball in the street with the Randazzo boys from across the street, and did homework with Henry Reed. I was seriously obsessed with flying model airplanes, especially the U-Control models, which flew in circles guided by a pair of thin wires. I was, as usual, always short of the cash needed to buy bigger motors, more paint, bigger planes. Dad bought a Speedy Mart grocery store and worked 16 hours a day, 7 days a week, for 2 years. After school, I ran the cash register, selling beer, milk, bread, cigarettes, and candy bars. I set up the largest candy rack in the neighborhood and dominated the youthful sweet tooth market. Mom and Dad were planning to have a baby. I built a model of the Vanguard satellite for my science project that year. The Vanguard was supposed to be the first satellite into space, but the Russians surprised us with Sputnik, and our Vanguard crashed on the launch pad. The space race was officially on. Brother Bob was born in 1957 when I was 13 and my life changed. Mom had to quit working at the store. I learned to change diapers, feed baby Bob, and gave up on any hope for a new family car. I would have resented babysitting in the evenings, but my social calendar was far from full. I built airplanes, did my homework, and enjoyed an occasional birthday party. During that summer of 1957, Mom and Dad drove to Las Vegas for a short vacation. On one night, they took me to a Vegas floor show. I had about 4 7-ups with cherries and felt a little grown up. We stayed at the Baghdad Motel. In the fall, I entered Grossmont High School, qualified What a scene. My close friends now included Bob Havens and Gary Rubin. Gary was the coolest guy I had ever met. I envied his style and his wardrobe. Nobody in El Cajon wore hats, but Gary had a collection and wore them with style. In our freshman year, Gary's father, a dentist, drove his sports car off a cliff. The insurance company called it a suicide, and Gary never talked about it. Bob, the class wit, moved to Culver City after his sophomore year. We reconnected years later, however, when I found his father living in our Palos Verdes neighborhood. As a sophomore at Grossmont, I added Russian to my curriculum and corresponded with a girl from Moscow. Dating was a major topic of conversation. How to meet girls, what to say to them, how to go about making out. These were discussed endlessly. Christine was born just before Christmas 1958. Grandmother Margaret came down from Long Beach to help Mom. They had their hands full now, and Dad had to let the store go and take a different job. After a training program, he bought a truck and joined up with Mayflower as a furniture moving van operator. The house was full of kids, toys, diapers, and visitors that year. Mom wanted me to believe that my big brother role was critical, but I was focused on my studies and getting a driver's license. My Russian teacher sent me to the foreign language field day at San Diego State that year. There was no competition in Russian, but there were several Spanish events, and I was excited to win a ribbon. On May 25, 1959, I got my driver's license at the age of 15 and a half, much to the envy of my friend Carmine Randazzo across the street. I drove with Henry and Gary to the Ingmar Bergman movies. I drove to the college library on weekends. I drove to Mission Beach in the summer, and on rare occasions, I even drove to school. Entering my junior year at Grossmont, I was pulling ahead of my classmates academically, but failing to make the tennis team. Mom loved her babies and couldn't stop taking pictures of them. Christine was the love of her life, and Mom took lots of pictures. Dad was making good money driving for Mayflower, but was gone most of the time. Mom cared for the babies, cooked for me, and left me alone to pursue my studies and my friends.
Will I be handsome? Will I be rich? I tell them tenderly.
During the decade, I had attended six different elementary schools, one junior high, and one high school, and lived in six cities. For many of the years, I felt alone and afraid. But as the years in El Cajon passed, I gained confidence, built friendships, and looked forward to the 60s.
What will be, will be. Que será, será.